Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. And Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Song to rise to you when temptation comes my way. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. 'Cause Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you.
Let's read together Joshua 1, verse 9. This is my command, be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go.
My name is regret. I'm pretty sure we have met. Every single day of your life, I'm the whisper inside that won't let you forget. Hello, my name is defeat. I know you recognize me. Just when you think you can win, I'll drag you right back down again till you've lost all belief. Oh, these are the voices. Oh, these are the lies. And I have believed them for the very last time. Hello, my name. The one true king. I've been saved, I've been changed, I have been set free. Amazing grace is the song I sing. Hello, my name is child of the one true king. Whoa, 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 whoa.
morning. I am so glad to see each one of you. And just like Rahelio said, like all of us feel, it is so good to be here with you this morning. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, thank you. Thank you that we as your children get to gather together here and to worship you. Father, I also thank you for those who are unable to be here, still be able to gather via the internet. Father, the things that you've allowed us to do these days and still glorify you is just heartwarming, Lord. Father, as we spend time together in worship, as we focus our hearts and minds on you, Father, may all that we do and all that we say bring glory and honor to you. This we pray in your Son's holy and precious name.
It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. all the earth. Jesus, glorify thy name, glorify thy name, glorify thy name in all the earth, oh, in all the earth, oh, in all the earth, Jesus, glorify thy name, glorify thy name.
Oh, praise the Father, praise the Son.
above all other names.
Good morning. Today is Father's Day. For some, it is a glad and easy celebration and remembrance. For others, is a day mixed with sorrow and regret for a relationship that once was and now is gone, or for a desired relationship that was never possessed. That makes worship easy for some and difficult for others. So whether Father's Day is either glad or sad, we must find the object of our worship to be greater than our earthly relationships. Listen to this portion of a letter Jonathan Edwards wrote to his daughter Lucy shortly before his death. Dear Lucy, it seems to me to be the will of God that I must shortly leave you. Therefore, give my kindest love to my dear wife and tell her that the uncommon union which has so long subsisted between us has been of such a nature as I trust is spiritual and therefore will continue forever. And I hope she will be supported under so great a trial and submit cheerfully to the will of God. And as to my children, you are now to be left fatherless, which I hope will be an inducement to you all to seek a father who will never fail you. Who is this father in heaven that will never fail that dying man? Who is this father in heaven that will never fail, that a dying man can take a great comfort in him and offer him as an encouragement to his children? On one occasion, the disciples heard Jesus praying, and the significance of that prayer was so impressed them that their immediate response was, "Teach us to pray." So Jesus taught them. What followed was not a formula for us to pray, but a model to teach us how to pray. And it begins not with a confession, not with a petition for our needs, not with thanksgiving, but with a recognition of and a commitment to our relationship with God, our Father. Those two little words, our Father, are so commonly used in prayer today that the significance of Jesus' use of them is now lost. But the turn of a few pages in the Bible back to the Old Testament quickly reveals that with this phrase, Jesus was inaugurating a radical understanding of God. In the Old Testament, God is never directly called Father. And in fact, there are less than seven references to him as Father. So to the ears of his listeners, not only did it appear presumptuous that Jesus should call God Father, but it was also preposterous to suggest that anyone could have such an intimate relationship with the sovereign creator and sustainer of the universe that he could be called Father. Then something even more amazing happened. Following the resurrection of Christ and his appearances, which were delightfully shocking in themselves, he spoke words to Mary in the garden, which were equally as shocking as his appearance. "Go to my brethren and say to them, I ascend to my Father and your Father, and my God and your God." Throughout the Gospel of John, the emphasis has been made that Jesus was singularly unique because of his heavenly authority that had been granted by the Father, and that he had been sent as an emissary of the Father. And then, after the resurrection, he astounded Mary and the disciples with this truth. They have the same Father. They have the same eternal security. They have Christ as their brother. They have the same indwelling Spirit. They do, and so do all believers. Further, by not only being allowed, but encouraged to call him Father, God demonstrates that he has a son-like love for us. Not only are we called his sons, but we are his sons. No longer is there a love that needs to be earned or an angry father to be appeased. As believers in Christ, we are eternally secure in his love for us, content that his wrath has been forever appeased by Christ's work on the cross. So on Father's Day, whether you are sad or glad, let this be your deep satisfaction and joy. God in heaven, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Eternal Father, the Prince of Peace, He is your Father. You are completely secure in His unchanging love. He delights in your fellowship and in giving abundantly all that you need. He is your Father. Father, we thank you for this day we get to celebrate, Dads. We thank you for adopting us into your heavenly family. As we worship today, help us to love you more, and let us never take your love for granted. In your name we pray. Amen. Now, if you'll follow in the good confession, I believe with all my heart that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God.
So many new things we have to get used to. New ways of collecting the offering, new ways of taking communion, new ways of wearing masks in church. Like you, I'm not used to it either. As we focus our hearts on giving to the Lord, I know that the offering has already been collected for many of you, but I like it be able to focus our hearts on why each week. In the Sermon on the Mount, in Matthew chapter 6, Jesus starts to talk about worry. Many of you know about that section. It says, you know, don't worry about your life, what you'll eat or drink, or about your body or what you wear. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothes? And he talks about how the Lord takes care of the birds and how he deals with the flowers and clothes the earth. And then down in verse 33, he says this, "But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." When we give to the Lord, one of the things we're doing, we're saying, "God, I'm trusting you. I'm trusting you with everything in my life. I'm touching with my finances. I'm touching with the decisions I make. I'm trusting you." And I know for many of us these days, situations some of us have had to go through, trust is not always easy. Trust is easily broken. But one who has never, ever done a thing for us to lessen our trust in is the Lord. Let's pray. Father God, thank you that we can place our trust in you, that we are able to give to you all that we are. Father, I thank you for blessing those who have given today. I thank you for blessing those whose hearts are on your given to you, that we are trusting in your kingdom and not our own. Father, as we strive to serve you, we ask that you would guide us and lead us. I ask your blessings upon the offerings that are received, that they may be used to glorify you and your kingdom. Father, this we pray in your Son's holy and precious name. Amen.
In this very room, there's quite enough love for one like me. And in this very room, there's quite enough joy for one like me. And there's quite enough to chase away any gloom. For Jesus, Lord Jesus, He's in this bed.
I'm glad that God's people right now, everybody is well. We may not have excellent health for some of us, but being alive is such a blessing. Count us alive still. People keep getting the virus, and some of them survive, and some of them passed away. Jose told me to say hi to you. He's still being hostage by his family. No. But one thing he says is, please tell the church to pray for me. He says, and I've been praying for all of you. And when I first met Jose, Jose didn't know nothing about praying and, you know, all these things according to the scripture. And now he's thriving. He's thriving on that. Let's pray. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus, because we don't have something to call your name and say, I need this, or I want this, or healing for this, or healing for that. Right now, all the glory, all the honor is for you, for you alone, Father. And just take it as it is, Lord. May it be a good aroma into your smelling power. Thank you for every blessing that you provide on us. Thank you. Be with our pastor today as he is delivering the sermon. And just let your spirit talk to him and guide him in the things that he has to say. In Jesus' name, amen.
Who's always there when I need you? Saving every day. Who always comes to my rescue? Whenever I'm afraid. Who's the one that truly loves me? Like no
to a little bit earlier. I wanted to just share a little bit before I go on. For those of you who watched the show, you know this, but for most of us, I know you didn't. She got up, and she's halfway through her song, and Simon stops her, says, "You got another song?" She starts to sing the second song, and Simon stops her, and she gets another chance, and he said, "Why don't you go off practice and sing a song that is made for a guy? You know, a guy sings, and try doing that song." And she goes and practices, tries a show of this. And she comes back up and she says, "None of those songs worked." She's 11 years old. She wrote that song because of her father. And that showed on this week's America's Got Talent just before Father's Day, and so I quickly went to my computer, downloaded the video to be able to show you that, because to me, what she was saying about her father is one of the most purest things for a child to her dad. And for we, children of the God, that's the heart that we need to have for our Heavenly Father. Today's Father's Day. So I've taken a shift and we're looking at a Father's Day message, listening to your dad. Have you ever noticed how little children pepper you with questions? I read a story about a little four-year-old who did that with his mom. Mommy, where do babies come from? Not quite sure she wanted to get technical with her son just then, she replied, the stork. Okay. Mommy, who keeps bad people from robbing our house? The police, honey. Oh, okay. Mommy, if our house was on fire, who would save us? Well, that would be the fire department, sweetheart. Oh, okay. Mommy, where does food come from? Well, farmers grow the food, honey. Oh, okay. Mommy? Yes, sweetheart, what is it now? What do we need daddy for? Part of us laugh, but part of us hurt. This little boy's dad apparently wasn't necessary for help making babies. His dad wasn't necessary to help keep bad people from robbing the house. He wasn't needed to save them from a fire. He wasn't needed to supply food. So the question remained, if daddy wasn't necessary for those things, what good is he? That's become an overall attitude in our society. What do we need dads for? In a society that regards fatherhood as irrelevant, why would God believe in fathers? Men in general, and dads in particular, are considered irrelevant. A few years ago, Jennifer Aniston, actress from sitcom Friends, made this statement. Fathers are often inconvenient, and when it came to child rearing, they could be quite optional. If you look at the entertainment industry, we've gone from fathers know best to daddy's an idiot. Sitcoms, movies, even cartoons portray fathers as mindless, humorous, and even stupid. But the book of Proverbs paints an entirely different picture of fathers. Now granted, the writer of Proverbs is a father talking to and writing to his son, but this father isn't just any father. He's a man who is inspired by the Holy Spirit to give us God's wisdom. And God's wisdom throughout Proverbs about fathers is this. Proverbs 6:20, keep your father's commands. Proverbs 23:22, listen to your father who gave you life. Proverbs 13:1, a wise son heeds his father's instruction. And Proverbs 4:1, listen, my sons, to a father's instructions. Pay attention and gain understanding. And of course, our passage this morning, Proverbs chapter 4, verses 3 through 7. We read, when I was a boy in my father's house, still tender and only child of my mother, he taught me and said, lay a hold of my words with all your heart. Keep my commands and you will live. Get wisdom, get understanding. Do not forget my words or swerve from them. Do not forsake wisdom and she will protect you. Love her and she will watch over you. Wisdom is supreme, therefore get wisdom. Though it cost you all you have, get understanding. In that passage alone, God loudly declares that fathers are critical. Throughout Proverbs, God teaches each and every son and daughter to listen to your dad. Your dad has things to tell you. He has things you need to hear. Now, why would God tell children to do this? Why command them to pay attention to their dads? Well, because the tendency, and especially with teenagers, is to believe that their dads don't know anything. I know many of you have heard this quote from Mark Twain. He wrote, "When I was a boy of 14, my father was so ignorant I could hardly stand to have the old man around. But when I got to be 21, I was astonished at how much the old man learned in 7 years. Recent research indicates that dads are a vital resource to their children. And I want to share some of that research with you. The first is an extremely encouraging piece of information, but it's one that needs a little bit of explanation. See, research indicates that the best fathers are biological ones. That's one of the reasons why God hates divorce. It puts stepfathers in a very difficult position. They generally are not equipped to supply what the kids need. However, as much as I appreciate statistics, and as difficult as it is for stepfathers to step in to shape children's lives, the biological father, the one thing statistic does not take into account is the power of God to fix what is broken in people's lives. Yes, a biological father is the best father for a child, but a stepfather who heeds the things that we're going to look at this morning will have God's power to undo the damage that not having a biological father in the picture can create. On top of that, the statistics does not in any way take in consideration the position of an adoptive dad. My personal feelings, and yes, I am biased, the adoptive father falls between a biological and step. The principles of Scripture and the power of God trumps all. A dad, no matter what, involved in their kids, is very important, very critical. So there's a difference between ideal and what God can use. Some more research. Sons learn about male responsibility, achievement, suitable assertiveness, and independence best from their fathers. Young men and young boys who are around their dad and have a dad that lives his life in the way God wants it to can see the best way of these things. Taking responsibility, achievement, assertiveness, and independence. But on the other side, daughters who enjoy their father's experiences a healthier femininity. They feel worthy of love and they are more able to trust men that they marry. The father's involvement in their kids' lives bring about the best of them. You see, a father protects. They protect their daughters from abuse. They protect their sons from violence. They protect their wives from rape and assault, and they protect their neighborhoods from intrusion and disorder. Research also shows that fathers provide stimulating, exciting, rough and tumble play within limits. Children learn that biting and kicking and other forms of physical violence are not acceptable. They learn when enough is enough. My wife has experienced that often with some of the young kids in her class who just don't know. I remember one young man, and I'm not going to give all the details, but when he got to her class, he had never, even though he had a father, he had never experienced play with dad. And it took months for Lynn and grandpa to get this young boy to realize that biting and kicking and all of those things were inappropriate. A study among Texas prisoners showed that 90% of inmates did not learn to play as children or played abnormally. and the vast number of those prisoners had little or no relationship with their fathers. Research also shows that fathers stress survival skills. Survival skills of competition and challenge and initiative, risk-taking and independence. That's what dads brought to the table. Now, I need to step aside because I've been talking about all these things, and I know some of you have been thinking in your mind, hey, don't forget moms. Well, this is Father's Day, so it is a Father's Day sermon. Let me step aside and point out a few things of moms because this is also important. Mothers bring the emphasis on a social integration, relationships, and personal well-being. Researchers found that fathers stress fairness and duty based on rules, whereas mothers stress sympathy, care, and helping based on relationships. The point is this. Children learn the healthy use of power from fathers and love from mothers. Both mom and dad are needed in a kid's life. I know there's overlap. I know moms do some of what I said about dads, and dads do some about what I said about moms. But those where the strengths are at. And because of this last truth, researchers Wesley and Epstein said that only this kind of parenting produces predominantly emotionally healthy children. Research also shows that when fathers are involved in their children's lives, those children can expect improved verbal skills, problem-solving abilities, academic achievement, proficiency in math and reading. And I want to make sure I have this one in there because so often what those things are left to mom and mom alone. Mom deals with the education of the kids, which is also as importantly needed. But when dad is involved, the idea of this is important in my life becomes reinforced even more so. The most striking effect, particularly for sons, is a child's increase in empathy and compassion. When dad is involved in a child's life, a godly father, there's an increase in their empathy and compassion towards others. They begin to see life is not just about them. Males who exhibit antisocial criminal behavior almost never have a good relationship with their fathers. These are some of the reasons that God declared that He desired to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the hearts of the children to their fathers. What this tells me is that God believes in fathers. God has hardwired men to have a powerful impact on their children. Fathers are not irrelevant. Fathers are not unnecessary. Fathers are important. And God is telling us that the presence of godly fathers can make all the difference in the potential and the future of their children. God is looking to create successful fathers. But how do fathers become successful? Malachi 6:5, which we just looked at, implies first that dads are successful when they turn their hearts towards their children. When they spend time with their kids. Have you guys ever heard of a comedian and actor by the name of Billy Crystal? Okay. I'm going to share a story that I read about him. When his daughter, Lindsay, turned 11, Billy was in New York filming a movie, and he called his daughter, and he apologized for not being able to be there. Then he said that a package would be delivered soon to make up for his absence. Later that day, when Lindsay opened the front door, there was a 6-foot-high box on the doorstep wrapped in birthday paper. She began ripping open the box, only to find her dad on the inside. Billy said she hugged me for 5 minutes. It was unbelievable. Why would he do that? Well, when Billy was 15 years old, His father died of a heart attack. And he said, I missed 25 birthdays with my dad, and I'm not going to let that happen with my girls. That's the kind of father God calls us men to be. A father who wants to be there for his kids. But if we're going to be successful fathers, there's one more thing we need to do. Before I go into this one, I want to make a comment. The things I'm saying about dads, just like the things I said about moms on Mother's Day, are universal. Just because you're not a dad does not mean these aren't things that you need to have in your life. See, a father who wants to be successful will make sure that God is his first priority. Jesus said it this way, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Yes, I mentioned earlier that that is focused on our worries, but the reality is that verse applies to all areas of our life, especially in our relationships. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Now, I want you to turn, if you have your Bibles, to 1 Kings 11, verses 9 to 13. And I'm going to illustrate this from the Bible in a unique way. And as you're turning there, let me explain that the majority of the book of Proverbs was written by King Solomon. And that includes all the verses from Proverbs that we've already looked at this morning. Now, Solomon is famous for being the wisest man who ever lived. But at one point in his life, the wisest man did a very dumb thing. He got God very angry. Follow along with me as I read, starting with verse 9. The Lord became angry with Solomon because his heart had turned away from the Lord, the God of Israel, who had appeared to him twice. Although he had forbidden Solomon to follow other gods, Solomon did not keep the Lord's commands. Solomon, and as many of you know, married quite a few women. And he had quite a few concubines. And he had quite a group of women involved in his life. And one of the things he began to do was because most of these women were not Jewish. Most of these women were foreigners. And they had other gods. And he began to build shrines and places for them to worship. And then he began to go with his wives to worship there. Continuing. So the Lord said to Solomon, since your attitude and you have not kept my covenant and my decrees, which I commanded you, I will most certainly tear the kingdom away from you and give it to one of your subordinates. Solomon made God so angry that God was going to tear the kingdom out of his hands and give it to someone else. But notice the next verse. In verse 12. Nevertheless, for the sake of who? David. For the sake of David your father, I will not do it during your lifetime. I will tear it out of the hands of your son. Solomon had disobeyed God. He made God so angry that God intended to punish him by tearing up the kingdom. But because Solomon's father was David, a man after God's own heart, God said he would not do it, tear away Solomon's kingdom during his lifetime, but instead in your sons. But wait, there's more. Look at verse 13. Yet I will not tear the whole kingdom from him, that's Solomon's son, but will give him one tribe for the sake of who? David. For David, my servant, and for the sake of Jerusalem, which I have chosen. So in other words, Solomon angered God to the point to where the king was going to be torn apart in his son's lifetime, but not completely. Solomon's son be left with one tribe, the tribe of Judah. Why? For the sake of that boy's grandfather. For the sake of Solomon's dad. Because David sought first the kingdom and the righteousness of God. He brought the blessings of God upon both his son and his grandson. Now here's the deal. If you make God the first priority of your life, if you seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, your dedication to God will create an umbrella effect for your family. That's essentially what the fifth of the Ten Commandments tells us. We read, I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sins of the fathers to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commands. You can be stupid in your life if you want to. You can do things that are in direct disobedience to God. And your sin will not only damage your life, it will damage the lives of your children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. But you can break that cycle. You can decide to repent of those choices and seek God's kingdom and His righteousness. And if that's the choice you make, you can undo much of the damage your previous choices have brought about you. I'm going to take a pause from here. I'm going to do what I don't often do. I'm going to mention somebody's name. There's a man that I know who lived his life totally contrary to what God wants. But at one point in his life, he said, I'm done with this. I want to serve God. And I have watched that man's life and his dedication to God, which is not perfect, which is far from it. Talk to any of his kids, and they can point you a whole list of things he ain't doing right. But I'm seeing God's blessing, even in his imperfection, because his heart is turned back to God, pour into his kids' life and his grandkids' life. Not his great-grandkids, because Jerry ain't got none of them yet. We've seen God work these things. But the key is living your life for God. What that part of Ten Commandments is promising is if you love God and keep His commandments, He'll not only bless you, He'll bring His blessing upon your children, your grandchildren, your great-grandchildren, etc. for 1,000 generations. I know about you, but that's what I want. That's how I want to live. I want to live in such a way that I know God will protect my son and his kids after I'm gone. That will be an ultimate inheritance to leave to our children. With all that said, there's an elephant in the room. There's a reality we cannot ignore. Not all dads are good men. Not all fathers step up and invest in their children. Not all fathers dedicate themselves to God. Some dads are godless, selfish, and cruel men. It's almost as if they've orphaned their children. They are not men who are there for their sons and daughters. They don't give them a proper example in their lives. It's like they've left their children fatherless. In that case, Psalm 68, a psalm written by Solomon's dad, tells us that God is the father to the fatherless. If you belong to God, even if you don't have a daddy, God is saying, I'm your daddy. I know that's got connotations, but still, you've got a father. You've got a dad. Romans says that once we become Christians, we receive His Spirit. It says you receive God's Spirit when He adopted you as His own children, and now we can call Him Abba, Father. The word Abba there, in many commentaries, points out that's the word for daddy that little children call their fathers. We can now call Him Daddy, Father. When you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, when you accept that you've sinned and you've fallen short in your life and are willing to repent and that you need a change in your life now, when you're willing to confess that Jesus will now be the Lord and Master of your life, and when you're willing to allow yourself to be buried in the waters of baptism and risen up as a new creature in Christ, When you've done all of that, you get to call God your father. And no matter what your earthly father was like, you now have a heavenly father who is better than even the best father that's ever lived. Now there's one last thing we need to address. In Ephesians 6, verses 1 through 3, we read this. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise, so that it may go well with you, and that you may enjoy long life on the earth. We need to honor our parents, and that includes dad. I have a good friend of mine. Variety of circumstances we're not going into. His children were taught that they did not have to respect their dad unless their dad earned it. That they did not have to honor dad because dad wasn't honorable. And so for most of his kids' lives, they lived under that impression. And recently, his kids have been discovering that that was a lie. And they're finding out how important dad would have been, could have been in their own lives. The Bible tells us that we've all sinned and that we've all fallen short of the glory of God. Now, I believe that I have some really good parents. I'd say even great parents. But they've sinned and they fell short of the glory of God, just like you and I have. All parents have sinned. All parents fall short of the glory of God. And the truth be told, it's hard to honor imperfect parents. Sometimes it's really hard. But God teaches us that it is crucial that we honor our parents. And so God made the commandment of honoring your parents the only commandment in the Ten Commandments to have a promise attached to it. It's the only commandment that says, if you do this, it will go well with you and you will enjoy a long life on the earth. But why should I honor a father who isn't all that he should be? Why should I honor a dad who doesn't live an honorable life? Well, because I'm a Christian. That's the only reason I should do anything in my life. Once you and I become a Christian, God became our Heavenly Father. You and I belong to Him. And He calls to us to minister to our earthly father, to our parents. He calls us to be missionaries, ambassadors to them. He calls us to share the joy and hope that Jesus brought into our lives with the one who gave us life. Sometimes that's easy. Sometimes it's not. But we do it because of a relationship with Christ. How many of you have heard of the professional football player by the name of Jim Sean Hennessy? My note says, you won't have very many people raise their hands. And I see that nobody's raising their hands. Well, this is a real town, Oil Trough, Pennsylvania, where he grew up, they've not only heard of him, they actually annually celebrate Jim Sean Hennessy Day. See, he was the football player of this town. He played a rough form of football known as smash mouth football. Sean Hennessy was a tough, mean, angry, motivated football player. And he was not the kind of player you wanted to be on the other side of the scrimmage line from. He hurt you, and he enjoyed doing it. His nasty, aggressive style of play earned him a full scholarship at Arizona State, and eventually he was drafted into the New England Patriots. And that might be why you've never heard of them, because the Patriots, well, they're on the other side of the continent. And according to my wife and my son, that's not a team to cheer for. But that's got nothing to do with the story. But the question is, how did Jim become so nasty? As he was growing up, his dad would beat him on a regular occasion. He said, my dad would paint the kitchen with my blood, and then he would beat up my mom before my eyes. that kind of abuse shaped his personality. He recalled, "I was in hundreds of barroom fights and I never lost a single one. Those fights generally started when Jim saw a man hurt or insult a woman at the bar. When that happened, he'd light the man up in repayment for the abuse he'd seen his mom receive from his dad. But in Jim's junior year in college, his life changed drastically. The man who wrote this account about Jim's life explained that he had a head-on collision with a crucified man. And he used those three nails of Christ's cross to pin his anger permanently on his own rugged cross. Jim became a new man. Shortly after his conversion, Jim met a man by the name of Gary Smalley. Smalley challenged him to forgive his dad and to go home and seek reconciliation. Gary asked, Jim, how much, essentially, Jim stated that there was no way that he was going to happen. So Gary asked, Jim, how much of your broken relationship with your dad is your fault? Jim became angry and said, 3% at most, 97% of it is my dad's fault. I want that to sink in. Because many of us, that's kind of where we go. Gary's response was this. As a follower of Christ, Jim, you need to take 100% responsibility for your 3%. Somehow that made sense to Jim. So Jim went home to find his father hadn't changed much. His dad was rude and insulting and constantly ridiculing his son. This made his mission difficult, but Jim was determined. He asked his father for forgiveness. He apologized for everything he had ever done to his dad. But the magic moment didn't happen. His dad wasn't impressed. Instead, he just kept on insulting and belittling his son. And this shook Jim so much that he began to cry. Then, almost without realizing he was doing so, he began to pray out loud. God, my father, I just ask that someday my dad could come to know you as his father as you have allowed me to know you. To Jim's surprise, he saw his dad begin to weep. He suddenly saw his father as a broken and bitter old man. And when he heard his dad begin to pray, God, someday will you let me know you the way Jim does? That single incident broke the barrier between them, and Jim's dad gave his life to Christ as well, and for the first time in his life, he began to experience peace. For the remaining 14 years of his dad's life, Jim and his dad prayed together, played together, and traveled together to places his dad had always wanted to see. Jim's relationship with Christ broke the cycle of death his father was in. When I first read this story, and when I'd gone over it a couple times, my mind keeps going back to this reality also. This is a story of the power of God. It's also a story of a changed heart. It's not a story of a magic solution. It's not something that if I do this, God will change my father. Because fathers still have choices. I can think of a couple stories of people I know who have gone through similar attempts with their own dads and nothing happened. My grandfather, to the day he died, rejected Christ. Regardless of how much my dad and my mom and myself shared with him. But I've seen enough stories like this to show that when someone's heart allows it, our influence can change greatly people's lives. I started this message with the question, what do we need dads for? In a society that regards fatherhood as irrelevant, why would God believe in fathers? God believes in fathers because God created fathers to be special. Be the father God created you to be. Be the son or daughter God wants you to be. Listen to your dad. You just might hear what God wants you to hear. In a minute, we're going to be singing the song, Seek Ye First. As fathers, we need to commit ourselves to seeking first the kingdom of God. As fathers, we need to commit ourselves to seeking after His righteousness. And by doing so, we can be the person our Heavenly Father wants us to be, the son or daughter that He wants us to commit ourselves to being. And by doing so, we can be the child of God our Heavenly Father wants us to be. Father God, thank you. Thank you for the opportunity that we have to seek after you. Thank you that you've put fathers into our lives to be able to bring to us that which you have for us to learn. Father, thank you for the fathers that we know that have put you first, made you a priority in our lives. And Father, for the influence they've had over their kids is just so insurmountable. But fathers sometimes have a difficult. And now sometimes we have a difficulty with fathers. But Father, help us as your children to show this world that fathers are not irrelevant, but fathers are important. Father, as we leave here today, may we be not only ones to bless those in our lives, but be able to bless the fathers that are in our lives. Father, and most of all, we want to honor you as our Heavenly Father, because you have stepped in and you have put your arms around those whose fathers were not there, have not been there, and you strengthened and you've encouraged. Father, as we go from here, may we live our lives in such a way that gives you glory, honor, and praise. Father, this we pray in your Son's holy and precious name. Amen.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray,
unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We are your church, we need your power in us. We seek your kingdom first, we hunger and we thirst, refuse to waste our lives, for you're our joy and prize. To see the captive hearts released, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace, we lay down. Church, we pray, revive this earth. Build your kingdom here, let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand, heal our streets and land. Set your church on.
We'll be right back.